into it and get you ready for the weekend by sort of doing a soft approach to the whole thing. We have decided to abandon that plan and start this convention by standing you up, turning you around, and kicking you squarely in the bottom. Ladies and gentlemen, the star of the Supernatural spin-off, Wayward Daughters, Brianna!
Fun way I know you're all thinking about, or is that just me? Okay, copy that. It was a jet lag night.
Well, next time you need to go over to your buddy Bobo and get a fistful of the drugs he carries around. Everybody's packed to deal with narcotics.
I love it. There's always someone there to offer me drugs around here.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
We're a drug-fueled group. I mean, I can't think of any time we haven't all been high as kites during this show.
That's true. That is very true. They don't like that.
Sometimes the truth hurts. Ladies and gentlemen, Brianna Buckmaster.
Thank you. Mike Borja here, he's got me terrified because he mentioned that he thinks that our hotel is haunted. And now I'm just going to take that. I didn't think that before, and now I'm terrified. But I think I was just awake because in my life it was dinner time. Oh, that was the other thing, is I was awake and starving. I was just like, there's no food in this hotel. This is so weird, I can't see any of you. Hold on. There we go. Hi guys, there's a lot of people here. Hi everyone! Oh, did you guys miss Kimberly? Yeah, everybody send her a tweet. Say, we miss you, and Brianna misses you, and she's fucking everything up. Just kidding. Sorry, I swear a lot to those who haven't met me. For those who have, you're welcome. So I'm here to talk until they tell me to stop talking. And I will do just that, and I literally will yammer on as I am now about nothing. Unless you force me to do something different. So there's nobody asking, nobody's questions? I'm gonna start talking about my period. Okay, not kidding. Oh, here they come. Yeah. See, it's always, no matter what, it's all it takes. Right, we're like, it was about 2.5 weeks ago. Okay, hello.
Hello?
Hello?
Okay. Have you any original songs for your album?
Ooh, okay. The album, which I feel like I was just talking about in the meet and greet, I feel like I'm not going to say out loud when it's coming out, but it is very soon. And I just finished the final mixes. There'll be 8 songs. And there are 3 originals. Not written by me, but written by people you know and love. I think that the idea of writing music for an album was so daunting that I didn't know where to start. And Jason was so great. Jason's like, you know, just write about anything. He's like, just write a hook, you know, or a chorus, or just a line, and then, you know, we can work from there. But the people that I was working with, everybody was you know, it's hard to devote months and months and months to an album, like I think that musicians often do, so I didn't, it was hard for me to reel in some assistance in that way. So for this album, I chose to do half covers, half originals written by people who knew what they were doing. And then Jason and I have already started to talk about a second album. So pretty excited about it, I'm not gonna lie. I'm excited to perform some of those songs live because actually in the studio it was a very different process for me because when I'm in the studio, usually I'm doing voiceover. I do voiceover work a lot in Vancouver, and you have to be very specific, and you have to say certain things at certain times. Whereas when you're in a studio, the idea is that you're free, like you would be on stage, and that was very hard for me. So sometimes I feel like I will be better singing these songs live, but you guys, of course, will be the judge of that. Thank you. Bless your heart. Oh, hello.
We saw kind of a darker side to Donna in the episodes that you were in the series, and quite loud.
Is that you or me? It's you. It's probably you. Probably you. Just kidding. Go ahead. As you were.
It's actually quite a serious question.
Sorry.
So from what we saw, we know that Donna's very protective over her family. My question is, which brother would you say that Donna is more like, Sam or Dean?
It changes. Originally, she was very reflective of Dean's personality, the comedic side of Dean, right? And Jensen and I have talked about that a lot. Jensen actually said that he thinks that me, Rihanna, is the female version of him, Jensen. Mm-hmm. And we always make jokes about that because we're, you know, buddies and have the same sense of humor. But, I think that Donna was fairly optimistic, which I think Sam, for the most part, is or was, but things have changed a little bit. And so I would have said that, you know, she has the same ideas as Sam in that way. And now I'm not so sure. After that episode, I think Sam was very like, cut your ties and run. And Dean was like, whoa, dude. So I think it's, a little bit different in each episode. But she likes food. I mean, fuck, who doesn't, right? Straight up this morning, I got asked for a breakfast sandwich, and my sandwich literally had bread and bacon in it. And I was not miserable. Just eating bacon out of a bread bowl. So I think that she's a good combination of both, but really, I think that, we were talking about this morning again, what's great about these female characters that is especially happening now, lately, I'm going to say this season, I've been really paying attention, is that the characters are complex, which is new for television, having complex female characters. We aren't just, you can about that. They're not just moms, and they're not just enemies, and they're not just the girlfriend. They have, does she want me to hold her? They're not just, they're interesting and they have a lot to say. And Donna, as everybody thought, was an optimist and, was always the one to go to about the good things. That might change now because she has fucking bad luck, you know? So we'll have to wait and see. Thank you for your question, Grumpy Baby. Hi. Oh my gosh, she's gonna start screaming. I know. So many F-bombs. Hello. What's your name? She's not a big talker, huh?
Get it.
Oh, you're in trouble now, Mama. What's your name? Aubrey. Okay, I can't tell if it's you or me, which accent it is. It's Aubrey in the English accent, and Aubrey in the Canadian accent.
Yes, I'm Canadian. Woo!
Oh, yeah, Canada! Yeah, I like it. Hi.
Hi.
I know this one. Which guy?
I just wondered what this book is about. I'm having a camera in this
book. Well, Jason's a piece of shit. Just kidding. Sorry, youngsters. Jason is amazing, and I don't think I could do the process of that album with anybody else because he kept me calm. We have very similar ideas. I feel like he knows my voice better than I do because of musical theater, I was told to have a different kind of quality to my voice for the majority of my career, and he was like, no, this is you, and he's right. We had some different ideas on things like pacing and stuff like that, but for the most part, worked together great. It was really fun. He'd come pick me up every day. I had an Airbnb. He'd come pick me up. We'd go get coffee, and then we'd be in the studio all day long. And just singing and talking, going for more coffee. Then we'd always have somebody come and visit the studio or somebody that was recording with us that would come. Emma was great because I don't think that she has ever... I'm singing one of Emma's songs. So one of the songs on the album was written by Jason and Emma. It's called Good Love. I don't know if I'm supposed to tell you that, but I'm telling you anyway. And I love it, and they wrote it, and Jason loved it so much, and he was like, I don't know if it's right for your album, but I would love for you to take a stab at it, and I loved it. All the songs on my album are very different. There isn't one genre in the album, and this one is going to be a mix of a bunch of stuff, which is kind of what I love about it. And so this song is a pop song, and Emma came and she's singing on it, on the song. She's singing, like, BG backups, right? And she is such an this is Emma Fitzpatrick, who's the lead singer of Bon Nouveau. And I met her, yes, oh my God, yes. I met her doing Rockwood, right there. Rockwood Music Festival, it's my favorite festival of the year. And she is such an unbelievably talented singer. Like, it is very rare that I aspire to be like someone who is so different from me. Different vocally, like we have polar opposite singing voices. But she's so talented, she's opera trained, she's been singing since she was a little kid. And so she came into the studio and she would guide me, which was great. She would direct me and where vocally to go. She'd try this, and both of them were very supportive because I was very nervous because I'd never done anything like that before. And I'm so grateful that all these kind of musicians came together to help me on this album. One of the musicians on the album, the piano player, was nominated for a Grammy. And I'm just like, he's just like playing on my little album. Such a big deal to me. Billy's also playing on it. The stuff that Billy does is unbelievable. Rob is singing on it as well. Rob wrote a song for the album for me, which was kind of dope. Really, 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 really great experience, and I'm already excited to do it again because now I know a little bit more what I'm doing. Thank you. Bye. Thanks, bye. Hi.
Hi. So you recently got to do a stage show and showed us a lovely little tour of the human set.
Oh, yeah.
What was your favorite part of that?
Okay, so I just finished doing a run of a play called The Humans. Yeah, oh man, it was so great. I saw that play on Broadway when I was in New Jersey for a convention about, a year and a half ago? Let's say a year and a half ago. And I saw this play and I was like, holy shit, like, this play is so dark and funny and sad. And it won the Tony, it was nominated for a Pulitzer. It, you know, was on Broadway, so I knew it was going to be touring around the regional theaters the year following. And I was like, oh, if this ever comes Canada, I want to try to audition for it. And I sure should have found out they were doing it in Vancouver, so I contacted the theater and asked them if I could be seen for it. And then I got the part, and I was so excited. I have a theater degree, and majority of my acting career is in theater. So it was so nice for me to go back to the stage. It's such a, I mean, obviously, I'm just like playing with my bra on stage here. Like, I'm so comfortable on stage. And it was, such a great time for me to come home to that. And also, when you're acting for the stage, you're kind of just acting. You're just being, and you get to do it for the length of that show, which was about an hour and a half. I was on stage for the whole hour and a half. You don't leave the stage. And as much with television. Television is a lot of like, stand and say your line. So you better be sure that you're a good actor behind that, because the directors are often looking at lighting and sound and other things. So they hired you because they know you can do the parts, so you just do it. Whereas then when I was doing the stage show, I got to dissect the script and talk about what it meant in the world. And it was fascinating for me, and it was so great to be home, back on the stage. But and man, is theater a lot of work. It was just like rehearsing 6 days a week, 9 hours a day, and then the show goes up and you do 8 shows a week. And so by the time it was done, I was done with it. Not done like get away from me, just like, okay, I'm tired, I'm ready to go back to the convention circuit. I missed you guys. I missed 3 conventions to do that play, and I knew for a long time that I, you know, was gonna have to do that. So I was grateful for the play, and I'm grateful to be back.
We're grateful you're back as well.
Oh, bless your heart. Thank you. Get my steps in, y'all. Hi. Big one, so I don't take too many. Hi. Is this a funny question?
Not really.
Okay. I won't do a funny bit then.
It's not sad or anything.
Okay.
But Donna is a character a lot of people can relate to.
Yes.
And I look up to her as well. And I was wondering if you had any characters you look up to.
Characters?
Yeah.
You know what I always say, and people frown on this, and maybe they'll frown on this because of the revival, but I grew up with Roseanne. You know the TV show Roseanne? I grew up with that show because I grew up in a poor family. My mom was also the breadwinner, but she did not have a super glamorous job like I do. She's very blue collar. My whole family is. I want to say white trash, but I'm not going to. We were very cultured. We just didn't have a lot of money. And so my mom watched that show all the time because she found the character of Roseanne so relatable. Just like trying to make ends meet, a bunch of shitty kids messing up her house, doing what they want, not listening. And now as a grown-up, I'm like, oh my God, like that character is amazing. And Roseanne Barr paved the way for many women. Like, she wrote and produced that show against everything that was on television at that time. So I always say that I find that character really inspiring. Now, the revival, that character is a Trump supporter, which I won't get into, but I might change my answer. So I really, long story short, I really relate to characters, such as maybe you guys, that are someone I can really see myself stepping into, in a good way. Sometimes I look at characters and how they're going through their problems, and I reflect that upon my life and how I could possibly go through those problems. I would say that, because the shows that I'm watching right now are like Game of Thrones, and those are not characters I can relate to. I mean, I do have a dragon at home, but, you know. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Oh, so polite. So polite.
Hi.
Hi.
So first off, thank you so much for the Wayward Sisters episode, because I enjoyed that immensely. I think a lot of people have
it. Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
Thanks for your support. It's all you know that, right? Let's just take a second to applaud all of us here. So it wasn't just like, yeah. It's not like, we showed up and we're like, sure, let's check out and see what this Wayward Sisters stuff is about. Yeah. It's something that we'd all been working on for a long time.
Yeah, so what I was wondering about is, how is that going? Because like there was an idea that it was going to be a spin-off? Like, what is the process there? How is that going? Like,
well, the episode was a embedded pilot for the idea of a potential spin-off. It was initially supposed to be a standalone pilot, but they decided, which, thank God, it would be better as an embedded pilot, which really meant that you guys got to see it, because often pilots, you only get to see if the show gets picked up. And so sometimes audiences never get to see a pilot at all. So we got to film it, it got aired, and now we wait. And we should know next week. Which is crazy. And I don't know anything. I'm not hiding.
not that good of an actor. I don't know shit. I know stuff. You hear rumblings and little things from people, but the network is not going to tell you anything until they know for sure, which we're supposed to know next week. And as soon as I know, you'll know. Whether they like it or not. Thank you. Yeah, it's a very funny business. I've heard so many things, and yet everybody's like, don't get your hopes up. It's always, this is gonna be great, but don't get excited. And you're like, well, don't fucking tell me then. I'm just an easily excitable person. Hello.
Hello. Can I just say you're gorgeous?
Oh, thank you. Especially when I do that, right?
Okay, that's
fine. Bust these. I will bust them. I won't do it. This is my funny bit, is I try to stand on these.
But, oh no.
You can see it. Look at these people are like, it's going to take off my face, man!
I see that.
Look at it. That's dangerous.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
What you got for me?
Also about Wayward Sisters. My question is, do you see Donna moving in with Jody and the girls? Probably fairly early on in order to have adventures together, but I also think as a family unit that would be.
Yeah, I was thinking about that because I was like, they don't live. Sorry, keep going. Angel, did you? Go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, I could gush forever.
Hey, go ahead, then.
Gorgeous and lovely, and all the girls are just awesome.
You.
I love the pilot. Oh. And I think it's just so many the women characters.
What?
Every single one of them have their own character and they all have their strengths. They all can act so fantastically. Nobody's the same at
all. Alright, okay. Are they gonna move in together? Listen, oh look at my butt. Great. Glad you got that in focus. Thank you. I forget that they live in different cities, right? Sioux Falls and,
Yeah, Donna's in Minnesota. So she needs to go to Sioux Falls.
Right? Yeah. Where's Donna from?
Minnesota.
Where?
Minnesota.
No. She's from, Okay, never mind. I'll figure it out. I'm trying to think of one of my lines. She says it in my first episode, in that donut scene. She says it. Things like this just don't happen in... What? No, it's not Minnesota. This just don't happen in... God damn it! Okay, I'll figure it out. Okay, yes, back to your question. I don't know if they're going to move in together. I feel like that would be mayhem. I've heard many things. Really quick. One thing I've heard is that there will be a training area for all of the women, which is pretty cool. So I wonder if Jody's gonna move. Stillwater, that's it!
Good morning.
I don't know if she's gonna move in. I don't know that that's a good idea because it would be. We don't have to have all of the action happen in that house, and we certainly don't have to have all of the family interactions happen. Just as we saw in Wayward Sisters, the pilot, they could have family dinner every week. You know, people could come stay at Donna's. Shit could go down at Donna's, you know what I mean? There's a lot, the fact that they don't live in the same house, I don't think will be a reflection of how their relationship is. I think their relationship is a family unit. I think even more than a family, I think that they are a tribe, you know? They're an army, and they're going to be able to work together whether they live together or not. And I think that's something that should be said for all of us. Am I right?
Yeah.
Thank you. And thank you for all of your sweet words, you gusher. You said all those nice things about me. I didn't even ask you to. Hi. I am good. How are you?
I'm good. This is my first SPN Con, so thank you, Creation Entertainment.
Right. Yes, thank you, Creation Entertainment. And volunteers. Let's give it up for the volunteers.
I spontaneously decided I'm going to do a poll over the weekend. So I'm curious which you think are better, ninjas or pirates? Asking the big questions here.
I guess there's good and bad at both. I would say ninjas because, well, pirates do get to drink more. But ninjas seem more stealth. Like, I would like to be able to do a backflip.
Okay.
With a sword.
Who wouldn't?
Yeah, but I'd also like to be feared on the waters while also being kind of day drunk. That'd be fun?
That'd be torn.
Yeah, you get it. You're day drunk already, huh? I'll hook me up. No, don't. I'll fall asleep. I'm gonna go with pirates. Final answer.
I really agree with the pirates, because I'm in a pirate society and we raise money for the RNLI lifeboats.
Oh! So, and I said pirates!
And you were right on about the day drunk. It's like the whole weekend.
Oh, okay, alright. Pirates! Pirates it is! Pirates forever!
A ninja pirate would be even better than me.
There you go! Why aren't there ninja pirates? Why has nobody thought of
that? There is, but they're not stealthy, you don't know.
Oh!
Okay.
This was planned, wasn't it? I was worried about ghosts before. Now I'm worried about fucking ninja pirates.
Ghosts are pussies. My question, I got distracted by pirates, was the boys have got Baby, they've got the Impala, which is a character in itself, really. If Jody and Donna had to go with a vehicle, what would your dream be?
D-Train! Hello! You guys haven't seen Donna's sweet truck?
Yeah. But if you had like a Thelma and Louise classic car,
A classic car. I'm not as good at this as Kim is. Recently did something together that I'm not going to tell you about. And there was a car involved, and Kim was like, oh, that's Jody's car. And I was like, that seems like pretty slick for Jody. I think Jody is a bit more, this looks like a lot of upkeep. This is, it doesn't have any seatbelts. No, too much work. I'm fucking busy. Like, that's how I see Jody. I think Jody has like a super hot car. I think it's vintage. I think that, yeah, it probably doesn't have seatbelts. You gotta get in and out pretty fast.
That's what she said.
Yeah, you know how Dean is with Baby? I don't think Jody would be like that with a car. I think she'd be like, no, you're my car. Just get me where I need to go. You know? And this is my opinion. Kim might have a totally different... I know Kim has a different answer. We've talked about what Jody's car would be forever. She actually really wants Jody to drive a motorcycle. And we've talked to the writers about it. Kim's like, I'll get my license if you want me to. I do all the stunt driving for my truck, which is a Raptor. That is the biggest fucking truck I've ever driven in my life. But fun fact, I don't know if you guys know this, but I, as Brianna, not Donna, used to run a food truck. Right? Donna should do that in an episode. So I'm very good at driving trucks. What's funny is like for that episode, you know where Donna first drives up in that episode? So just as actors do with their bodies, they have to walk into a scene and hit their mark, which is actually very challenging without looking down at it. You have to do the same thing with vehicles. So all of our vehicles, there was three vehicles in that scene, had marks that we had to hit. And it is way more challenging to get a car to hit its mark, to drive in with purpose and hit its mark. And I did it every fucking time. And there's nothing to do in Saskatchewan to drive. Yes, so I've got my sweet ride. I don't want it to ever change. I love that truck. I got to use it in breakdown as well. and nobody's gonna drive that truck but Donna.
That's right, when she opens the back of the truck and it's got all the weapons in it, and she goes,
duh. Of course I've got fucking, you know, machetes in my truck. It's from Minnesota, you know?
I'm from Liverpool, I understand.
You get it. You get it. Okay? Thank you. Hello.
Hi, welcome to England.
Oh, what?
Welcome to England.
Oh my god, thank you so much.
You're welcome. I think you may have touched on the answer to my question a bit there. I love the episode Breakdown. I love the episode Breakdown, and I like Gatsby sorted on this character in that as well. And I was wondering what you found most challenging, or what stuck out for you most in that episode.
Oh, I love that. That episode was such a gift to me as an actor, because especially playing Donna, the character can get seen as two-dimensional because she's a comedic character, and that's nothing to be said about me or the writing or anything. That just often happens with comedic characters on shows that aren't comedic. So it was a concern of mine that I was always going to be the second banana, that I wasn't going to be seen as being able to move plot along. And I am, you know, as a person, I'm a you know, classically trained actress. So I was like, you can give things to me. I can do what I promise. And Davey Perez, who wrote the episode, I'd heard about this episode actually when I was going in to shoot Wayward Sisters, because it was the very next episode. It was slated to be the episode after that, and they're like, doesn't make sense to have a Donna in an episode, not in an episode, and then another episode. So they just put them together. Everybody on the crew was like, oh my god, I can write episode 11. Like, the crew was excited about the script. And this crew's been working together for 13 years, so I'm sure it's very hard for them to get super stoked about scripts anymore. So then that made me excited, and I read it, and I messaged Davey, because I was like, this is such a gift to me as an actor, and to Donna, to that character as well, because it gives her somewhere to go, going into the possible spinoff. And Davey had said, it doesn't make sense, like, that Donna was always in or about to be in or being brokenhearted by a man. And so he wanted to write a script that showed Donna being alone and not ending the episode with her going to be in another relationship. And I love that. I don't think that you have to have every woman hooked up with a dude to make for great television. The challenges for me with that were I'd never had to do emotional stuff on camera. In theater, sure, plenty, but it is a different challenge on camera to, you know, you have to shed the same tear at the exact same time for 6 takes in a row. And that was interesting. I was working with actor Brendan, who played Dougie, and such a great actor and such a great scene partner, because we would be able to rehearse. I'd also never rehearsed scenes before, and that was thanks to the director. So it wasn't as tricky as I thought it was going to be, but I definitely had to delve into parts of me that I had never had to do for Donna before, to find those emotionalities to hook me into those scenes. Usually I just kind of get to say the funny one-liners and, you know, walk off already being like, that was the best part! But yeah, so it was such a wonderful challenge for me as an actor, and I'm so glad that I got it for me, and I'm glad that I got it for Donna. Thanks, man. Thank you. Hi!
I was wondering what sort of words you live by in your sort of everyday life, because there was one you talked about in Vancouver where you say everybody poops, and that I just love that one. So I was wondering if there were any others that you had as well.
One-liners?
Yeah, sort of pearls of wisdom kind of thing.
Everybody poops. Well, I mean, that's hard to beat. My favorite one, the poop one, is like when, I think I said this on Twitter once, it's like, when you're feeling sad, when you're feeling like you just aren't making it in life, just imagine Beyonce pooping. Just imagine it. because she does. But she's still Beyonce. So I love to take those kinds of things and just go, hey man, every new day is a new opportunity. My favorite quote is don't let them tame you, which I've been told a lot over the last couple years. As a grown woman, it's so funny how you still are judged by others, and you realize that judgment of others is really based on stuff that's going on in their life. It's really not based on stuff, a reflection of you at all. It's their stuff. And so the more you can remind yourself that it's not about you, it's about them, it's so much easier to live your life as your own authentic self. And I'm a wild one. I know that. My husband knows it. My mother knows it. My child knows it. And those are the people that I'm really, those are the opinions I really worry about. Everybody else is just, you know, icing on the cake. So if I'm to give honest to goodness favorite advice, it would be don't let them tame you. Be you. Keep it. You're welcome. She's a wild one. I can tell. I can tell.
Hello.
Hello. How are you? Yeah.
What? That was a really good answer.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome. I'm here with my husband. It is our honeymoon.
Woo!
Okay, somewhere.
Stand up so I can see your sexy face. Yeah! Happy honeymoon!
Thank you.
There's no sexier place to be than at my panel.
Exactly. Okay. Apparently, we started an affair with the band on our honeymoon.
So you started an affair?
With the band on our honeymoon.
That's not such a bad thing to do.
No.
Well done.
Anyway, my question was, would you ever consider covering one of the Pretty Reckless songs?
Oh, I just... Didn't Kim do a Pretty Reckless song? Kim, I know Pretty Reckless. Well, I know the lead singer from Gossip Girl, but... Kim had been talking about a Pretty Reckless song. I feel like she did one. Did she? Somebody answer me. Yeah, okay. Yeah, they said, front row says yes, she did. I just put a pretty, I have all these playlists on Spotify. And now you're all going to go to my Spotify playlist. Damn it. They're not that good. But I just found a Pretty Reckless song and I don't remember what it's called, but I was like, oh, this band is great. And she is great. That lead singer, that is the epitome of someone who knows what they have to offer this world. And I love it. She doesn't give a shit what anybody thinks. Her voice is, her vocal quality is hers and hers alone, and I love it. So you've inspired me to actually go and listen to more Pretty Reckless.
Please do.
We're fans of Pretty Reckless, you know this band? Yeah? Okay.
Thank
you're
you.
Way, you're into it, right? Thank you! Oh, am I getting a signal? No? Okay. Oh, yeah. Billy Moran, everyone. Jesus Christ, Billy. Just come out if you want to come out.
Hi!
Hi. How do you think you'd be if you were a sheriff in real life?
If I was a what?
A sheriff.
Oh, I'd be fucking terrible. Oh my God.
I'd be like, it's
my rule! I made it up! I'll break it if I want to! And I'm inherently lazy. If somebody did something bad, I'd be like, ugh, don't do it again, okay? Thomas. I think it would be very tricky to be law enforcement. And I applaud those who are in law enforcement here. Okay. fuck them then, right? but yeah, I don't think I'm glad that I'm not. That's the great thing about being an actor, is because you could be like, I think I want to be a lawyer someday. You're like, no, just for a day. So I'll be a lawyer for a day, and I don't have to go to school, and I don't want anybody to actually be mad at me, and I want to win. And you can do all those things in a day if you're an actor. So, yay for law enforcement, but not a sheriff, I just pulled them on TV. Thank you. Thank you!
A lot of you may not know this, you do, some of you may not, that this lovely lady, who's not only a fantastic actress, has an unbelievable rock star voice.
Oh,
and she is not only recording an album, you're doing an album with Jason. Yeah. Is it recorded?
Done.
When are you coming out?
January
July! You want a teaser of what you're gonna hear on that album? Come check out Saturday Night Special up here with the Secret Big Band. Liam Nelman, Deanna Buckmaster.